What specialism do you work in as an occupational therapist, and what does your work involve? If I go to Chike first, if that's okay.
Yeah, so I'm Bantics Occupational Therapy. I'm based in the community at the moment. So I'm kind of supporting the transition from patients from hospital going back home. So, yeah, my job involves kind of collaborative work, working together with the patient, the carer, the family, just to kind of create goals and create plans to kind of help the transition back home and reintegrating them back into the community. So, whether that be with equipment, whether that be with kind of organizing the care plan and the structure to kind of support their day-to-day routine and ADLs, or kind of liaising with other kind of teams of the community, which they can engage in and access easily. So yeah, it's a very rewarding role. And we kind of we're a 6-week service. So during that 6 weeks, that's when they have kind of intense therapy input. So that would be with the physiotherapists, with the therapy assistants. And yeah, they'll go through exercise programs, practice transfers, kind of progress their mobility, whether that be with a frame, to a stick, to crutches, et cetera. And kind of, yeah, just kind of go about the role that way, really. So, yeah.
I'm sorry, I might have missed this. Is that at home or is it in hospital still where you
At
do it?
home. At home. So it's the transition from hospital to home. So I'll either go in their home, or if they're getting discharged into a care home or a nursing home or a residential home or an independent living centre, we'll still go out there and assess them within their home environment to kind of see what their baseline was and kind of devise a plan to kind of get them back to being as independent as possible.
Thank you for that. That's, you
Yeah.
know, as an educationist, that's my whole thing in that that occupation should be occupational therapy should be in real context. And for me, it's always about the home or like you say, about the residence or about work and things like that. And I know if there's a hospital occupational therapist amongst you, you might oppose that view, but we'll
Yeah,
see.
because I have my first job was band 5 rotation. So yeah, working in a hospital, I did feel at times I was quite restricted to kind of further my kind of goals and plans for the patient. And because it's quite most settings are quite acute settings in a hospital, it's very I found any very business orientated, and we need to discharge the patient as soon as possible. We need to kind of get them home so we free up the bed. So you couldn't really develop that relationship and that rapport as much with the patient in the hospital. But I find in the community, I do get more time to kind of see what their, you know, their hobbies, their goals are, and kind of create more, be more creative with creating kind of ideas to kind of get them to reach their goals.
Yeah, I guess the hospital occupational therapists are getting the patients ready for you so that you can start your therapy.
Yeah.
That's their role, isn't it, to make sure they can get them out
Yeah.
at home
So
safely for that to start the next therapy bit.
kind of that liaison and that kind of communicating with the OTs in the hospital to kind of see what how they progress so that you can kind of carry on into the community is very, very important, along with other MDT workers as well, the nurses, the yeah, the doctors as well, etc.
Yeah, thank you.
Nice.
Oliver, over to you. What's your specialism and what does it involve?
Okay, so I'm considered a social services occupational therapist. And what that means is instead of working for like NHS or health, I work for the local authority. And basically my role considers it incorporates quite a lot of things, but it's mainly sort of minor major adaptations, seating, moving and handling, what else, like right sizing, so ensuring that people have got the right level or packages of care, which can be quite interesting at times. So yeah, that sort of really encompasses what I do on a day-to-day basis. But because of the sort of the team that we work in, we have quite a lot of OTAs. So I have to supervise OTAs. where they will kind of, they will mainly do sort of the, some adaptations up to a certain point, but when it starts to become a little bit more complex, those cases come to me. So I find that mainly I'm doing sort of very complex adaptations and moving and handling. Those are sort of the two areas that I'm, would say that I specialize in. So yeah, that's me in a nutshell.
Oh, so when you say like complex adaptations, would that also mean like if there needs to be like structural changes to the home as well, so, would you get involved with that?
Yeah, so any like extensions, you know, through floor lifts, that sort of thing, that's where I would take over. But more the complexity for us in terms of in my role is more to do with the client's condition. And get, having a better understanding of how that condition might progress and what they may need in the future. And I suppose that's what kind of separates me from what the OTAs do. They kind of see the here and now and they prescribe based on that. Whereas with some of the complex cases, so for example, I've got a couple of cases at the moment who have got like MND. So it's thinking, okay, this is where they are now, but where are they likely to progress to in the future? And what does the property need to look like to enable them to access bathing, to be able to, you know, access different parts of the property, to be able to get in and out of their home? Do you see what I mean? So that's where I kind of come in. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like very interesting. It's like future-proofing, isn't it? Like making it ready for the next change in their function or level of ability.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And there's also a really heavy sort of pragmatic approach as well, because, you know, when you're working with taxpayers' money, you can't just be throwing things around. So it's really based on clients' needs. And we're always looking at, okay, what is the, without being cheap, but what is the cheapest way of meeting that client's need? Now, if basic equipment or simple adaptations can't meet that need, then that's when we start going down the route of exploring more major adaptations. And I suppose that the whole idea is to try and keep people in their homes, reduce hospital admissions. And I suppose from that perspective, although it is a lot of money, you might think, for example, I don't know, £40,000-£50,000 to do an extension, it is a lot of money. But if you can keep that person in at home and stop them from going into hospital, and, you know, it might even reduce the amount of care or input that they need on a day-to-day basis. So it's quite a complex thing, but a lot of the time the money that is spent can be justified because of the impact that it has on the client, but also the impact it can have on family, their mental health. I mean, it's a massive area.
Thank you, Oliver. Valentine, over to you.
Well, I work as an occupational therapist in a children and young people setting, it's a community mental health, so 0 to 18 years old. And I'm basically working within a team that assesses children for neurodevelopmental conditions. So it could be autism or, you know, or ADHD. So these are kids in, you know, who are in special or extenuating circumstances. So, the cases that come through to the service are quite complex. And for myself as a band five, it was my first role as well. So it's, you know, I'm surrounded by band sixes and, you know, I'm one of the few band fives that are there. So my role actually incorporates quite a bit of care coordinating. So the role of OT is kind of blurred with care coordinating. So sometimes I even feel like it's exactly occupational therapy that I'm doing. But what I do personally with kids, I help run virtual online groups as well as offer one-to-one therapy. There's a mixture of face-to-face as well as virtual, you know, virtual appointments that I do. And the particular interest that I have within this setting is running emotion regulation. Well, I tend to call it emotion regulation therapy. So it's more or less emotion intelligence work and getting kids to understand what emotions are and how they affect everyday functioning. as well as, you know, how it helps them mature, you know, as an individual. You know, having that process of transitioning from primary school to high school, and then eventually to further education if they wish to do so. So, and also a lot of work that I do is with parents as well, because, you know, a lot of circumstances that children found themselves in is sometimes, the end product of, you know, of the parenting. So I find myself sometimes parent meetings where we're offering strategies to help parents cope with the children's behavior, as well as working with schools, obviously. So it's quite a non-traditional setting, and that role of OT is quite blurred with being a community mental health practitioner. But there's so much creativity involved in this role. You know, unfortunately, I don't deal with equipment and major adaptations or anything like that. I'm more or less dealing with a human mind straight away, and a lot of talking therapy that happens. So, so that's more or less it.
Well, that's quite interesting. And can I ask, you know, because of the COVID-19 situation, can't get away from it, but are you doing more virtual therapy, or are you doing the same amount that you used to do?
Yeah, so funny, I started just before COVID kicked in, so I was doing face-to-face as usual, but then since outbreak happened, we've moved on to virtual. So literally Zoom or Microsoft Teams appointments, as well as telephone call. And it's funny, some kids have really relished, you know, some kids with neurodevelopmental conditions such as autism, they've really, really enjoyed being at home and being in that safe space, that environment. But it's been detrimental because it's set in a routine that's, you know, fortunately not realistic for most kids, where you have to go to school and where you're exposed to challenges, either socially and, you know, as well as sensory as well. So it's involved with virtual. So we've had to really find new ways, creative ways to work, and really consider, obviously, what the child is going through to either we're going to offer face-to-face or virtual. So
thank you for that. That was really interesting. I'm just thinking, I need some of that emotional regulation therapy at the moment, doing virtual online teaching. I'm having lots of emotional outbursts.
Yeah, it's a common thing, and I learn a lot, you know, about myself through doing it, as well as learning about my own children that I do have. And it's very practical, and there's limited OT research on emotional intelligence. But I think there could be more out there that could address, you know, how OT can definitely have an impact in this area. So really interesting.
Thank you, Vanten. And I can hear that whole ethos of family-centered therapy when you have a child involved in the therapy services, and how you have to look at the wider context of influence as well. And I heard that in your little commentary there. Thank you for that. Kwaku, I just realised you're last again. I'll make sure I don't do that again.
It's okay. So I work with young men in a prison setting. My trust I work for is comes under the forensic sort of mental health, but I would say that I don't work in the mental health setting. I try to remove myself away from that, because as soon as, you know, we talk about diagnosis and things like that, it makes it really difficult sometimes to break away from that thought and actually work with the young men. So I work with 18 to 21 year olds, so very, very dynamic, very active, very energetic, impulsive age. It's actually a fantastic age to work with, and it's a complex needs service. So it comes under the offender personality disorder pathway network across the prison services. So these young men have been deemed to be high risk, or have a high risk of violence or high risk of harm that they could potentially cause to other people, and also they may have had adverse childhood experiences and may display certain traits of different types of personality disorder, but due to their age, they're not diagnosed. So that's I actually love that aspect of my work, that none of these men are diagnosed with any sort of personality disorder, because you know that comes with its own stigma attached to that as well. I would say my role is a quite a generic role, but at the same time I have a very strong occupational therapy identity, because I think the people that came before me in the service made sure that there was an occupational therapy identity. But in general, I do very similar work to what the psychologist will be doing in the service. So I wouldn't call it care coordinating, but I call it key working. So I have my own caseload and I work with these young men for, let's say, if I'm lucky to get them at 18 years old, I can work with them until they're 21, until they leave the setting. So I could be with them for 3 years. And that's to work with anyone for that period of time is amazing. It's fantastic. You get to know them. You know, they get to know you. You build a relationship. And one of the things that we work on is relationships, because one of the things that goes wrong for them to be in prison is tends to be a breakdown in a relationship of some kind. Either it's involved in gang violence or sexual assaults. There's a breakdown in relationship and communication with them. So yeah, we in terms of that, we devise a formulation together, basically developing an understanding of what got them to be where they are now. So we talk about their upbringing, or the different developmental stages, the education, or the things that they like to do. This is when my OT mind comes in. So we talk about their patterns of doing, their routines when they were in the community, and what that meant to them. So when you're doing something in the community, if you're engaging in violence or engaging in any sort of behaviors which is not deemed as socially acceptable, there must have been a reason why you're doing it. What values were you gaining from it? What meaning did it mean to you? And that's when, like I said, the occupational therapy in me comes out a lot. Aside from that, we do a lot of interventions, occupational therapy specific interventions as well. We do a lot of sensory work in with the young men. We do a lot of creative activities. So we do like drama work, or I've done a dance group before with the young men. We've got a garden that we go in, arts and crafts, music, we've got a therapeutic music facilitator. So literally it's a bit of a free rein when it comes to using different activities and occupations in there. It's just about the interest of the young men. And at that age as well, they tend to be very, very creative. And that allows me, you know, free rein to use as many resources in the prison within the security systems as possible to get them to engage. And actually what I found is that the more that they engage in something that they particularly like, which is occupational therapy, in terms of meaningful activity, the more they're willing to share with me in during sessions. I'll give you an example. One time I was doing a music session, like I took one of the young men to the music room and we just listened to all the types of music he likes, you know, rap, hip hop, UK hip hop, drill music, everything he's listening to. But the amount of information I was able to get from him through that conversation, it was just amazing. And then a couple of weeks later on, he mentioned that he can't believe that he told me all the things that he told me, because it's not something that, you know, you go around sharing with anyone. So the power of occupation, the power of a meaningful activity in practice is very important in my role. But yeah, that's I really enjoy my role at the moment. So yeah, that's my specialism.
Wow, it sounds so powerful, just the idea that having routine and occupation kind of humanizes you again and makes you feel like you belong. There's a whole such a need to belong, to be loved and appreciated, feel like you belong somewhere, and you're kind of trying to bring that out again, that they've lost all of that.
It's an unpopular opinion in terms of, obviously, like sometimes when I've told people about my role, you know, the first thing people go to is about what about the victims? And that's absolutely fine. That's you know, we don't shy away from those conversations either. We don't shy away from talking about the crime they are in the prison for, the offense they're in the prison for. We don't shy away from that. And actually, it's talking about putting yourself in maybe the victim's position. And that what Valentine was talking about, the emotional intelligence and understanding what the emotions of the people around and the impact on the family. Actually, it humanizes the prisoner, the young man as well, because there's always a view that, you know, young men in prison or young people in prison or anyone in prison is really bad. Everyone's really bad. Everyone's really dangerous. But I always say they just need a bit of love, you know, they just need a bit of love. They just need a bit of love because the society's basically pushed them to the side. And, you know, when I actually do things with them, you can see the real side of them coming through.
Thank you.